they get there. In a Christian way, it's not a time where you are looking back and waiting for your other version, and I'm like, and you're trying, and because the more you say to yourself, this my brother is now coming, I don't think the group is going on again, so I might not come today because that my brother is not coming. That's something my pastor always tell me. He says to me, he says, when you go and catch a fish, and the fish is just too big, and you know the fish is pulling you down to the river, instead of falling in the river because you're trying to kill the fish, let the fish go. It's not a time where you should look at your brother and say, this my brother is no more coming again. But it's a time for you to keep marching forward. Even if we are just doing the group, don't feel bad. Don't think, is this group still functioning? You are not coming because of people. You are coming because of God. Because God said, when two or more, he didn't say when 30 people are in my group, in the group, I am here in their midst. He started with two. Even when you're just an only person, God is still with you. He started with two, the leader. He is there in their midst when even just two people. He didn't say when hundreds of people. He said when two people. Even if we are just three, let us continue. Because even the Bible confirms it. He said, many are called, but few are chosen. Just few. Like the last time, was it the chair of the Delphine? One of them is saying, okay, was it that time that I was saying, the group started with 23 people, and now we've dropped to 8, 9. Yes, it's bound to be like that because the devil, the moment, the last time I preached, I told you people that the moment you give your life to Christ, the devil started using different trials to like pull you down. The devil's aim is just to get you away from God. But don't look back. Don't look at those people who are left. Don't look at how many are in the group. Don't let those things discourage you. Let us still get encouraged. No matter how many people are leaving, this determines that I'm not going to leave. I will make it as long. Because by strength shall no man prevail. That group is not just a prayer group. It's a group where we have brothers and sisters in this group. We come together to encourage ourselves. We come and we share what is working us. And I'm like, brother, sister, I don't know. It's like I'm getting these people come and they say, I was praying and I fell asleep. I don't know. So it's a time where we need to encourage each other. It's a time where you need to be in the group because you need encouragement. Especially at this end time. Because the devil is really fighting in your heart. You take vengeance away from. You take vengeance away from the group. Because even God comes from it. God said, that holiness ministry, that is his own group. God is in this group. Don't look back and say, because this brother has gone, I'm going. Then because of that, you need to what God has for you. Everyone who has devoted their time to come to the group, there is always a blessing attached to you. You can do your personal prayer. Like when I was talking to Bertina, so I told you, I said, Bertina, so I left the group because I didn't come to the group because I wanted to do my personal prayer. But what did you tell me? He said, your personal prayer time is different for the time of the group. Everything you do, you're going to give an account of it. The group is a way that you get encouraged to carry on, because the devil is trying to take members away. But we shouldn't mind people that have gone, though we need to preach to them. But don't get discouraged. Don't say, the group is not functioning again. Yes, because this is the time such thing will come to your mind. When I came today, it was only three people that were in the group, but they didn't start. I was wondering, I'm like, even if you are just three, start up with something. Start up with three. God, there were two or more people are there. He is there in the midst. Even if it's just only two people that are there the midst. Let God come down and reign in your midst. So, brethren, let's not be discouraged. Even if we resist you, God is still in our midst. It's a race. People must fall. People must look back. But how many will make it at last? Many are gone, but few have chosen. My brethren, let us not be discouraged. Let's still keep looking up to where we are going to. Don't look back. Praise God.
Hallelujah. Thank God for His word to us today. Do not look back. Amen. We appreciate God for the opportunity to be here again. Brethren, little while we share the word of God, and I want us to close eyes and say, Father, help me that I will not look back. Any weakness, fatigue coming into me, help me that I will not look back. Draw us nearer, O God, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where Thou hast died. Draw us nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to Thy precious bleeding side. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. I don't know if we have the time to sing that hymn and take the message as well. But I think that if we know Him, if we sing that song and say, Father, I dedicate my life to you. The message might not be a very long one, but we must rededicate our lives to God. I cry to God, Father, I will not be among those who will fall away. In the name of Jesus. Let me get the lyrics of the hymn. Please sing that hymn. Draw me. First of all, wonderful Jesus. Let's begin. Let's sing and praise God. One, two, go. I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice and it told thy law to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Drawing near, blessed Lord, to the cross where Thou hast died. Draw me near, blessed Lord, to the precious bleeding side. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and I will be lost in time. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died, Jesus. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Hold the pure delight of a single heart that before thy throne I spend. When I redeem my God, I commune as friend with friend. Blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died, Jesus, draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Amen. I also want to lead us in the last stanza. Você está direto aí, né? Só já foi. Aleluia. Tá só um livro assim, last time. That's above every other name. In the name of Jesus, that the Lord will draw us continuously nearer unto Himself. Thou will not miss heaven, will not miss the mark. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Our God, we thank you for another day, another opportunity in your presence. As we continue, Lord, we ask, come and continue with us. Speak to our heart and have your way as we, oh God, enter into the study of the word. Holy Spirit, come and teach us. Open our eyes of understanding and grant us the revelation that we did indeed set us free. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Brethren, a few minutes now we'll be looking at the word of God, and by the grace of God, we'll be looking at the requirement or the danger of what? Of lack of love for truth. Praise the Lord. So we're looking at the book of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 from verse 1 to 12. Praise the Lord. So can Brother David Nyukuri read from verse 1 to 2 for us, please. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, from verse 1 to 2. Can he read that for us, please? Praise the Lord. Okay. Sister Scholastica, dear, can she read from verse 1 to 2 for us, please?
Second Thessalonians.
Chapter 2. Verse 1 to 2.
Paul and Silvanus and Timotheus unto the church of the Thessalonians in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Brother Rotundara, can you continue for us from verse 4 to verse 6? Praise the Lord. Is Sister Gerardi with us? Over 7 to 9.
For the mystery of iniquity that already works, and it is who now left us to live, and who keeps the things of the way, and then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord hath sealed to the spirit of his mouth, and hath destroyed the darkness of his coming. Even him, this woman is up to the working of Satan, all power and signs and lies and this.
Praise the Lord. Our sister Delphine, can you read for us from verse 10 to 12?
Yeah. And with all deceivableness of all righteousness in them that will perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, but they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them tribulation, that they should be alive. But they all might be damned, who believe not the truth and have flesh of his mouth. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Now we can see from the word of God that from verse 1 we can be preaching the coming of Christ is at hand. The coming of Christ is at hand. What we need to keep reminding ourselves of the details of what, how can we not miss his glorious appearing. Amen. Now this passage is telling us from verse 1, for you tells us that um Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit nor by word, nor by letter as from us. Amen. Don't let your mind be troubled. The coming of Christ is not something that brings trouble of the heart. Something that should bring what? Peace and what? Hope. Praise the Lord. You know, as that the day of the Lord of Christ is at hand, let no man deceive you by any means. And brethren, if you remember the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 24, when the disciples asked Jesus, what will be the sign of your coming? And Jesus, the first words Jesus said is what? Take heed, let no man deceive you. Why? Jesus, and even if you look here, he's saying that in the last days, there's going to be what? Great deception. That's why the much emphasis was put on deception. He says, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first. But it is very, very, very serious. Because the Bible says that Jesus will not come unless there be a falling away first. What does that mean? That people must fall. My God, this is a very serious statement. And that the Son, man of sin, be revealed, the Son of Perdition. Brethren, that the Son of Perdition. I used to think that the Antichrist is not going to come. But the Bible said that man will be revealed. Amen. You see here that there will come a falling away first. Praise the Lord. Let's look at the Bible is written in English. We can always check the meaning of the words in English. Praise the Lord. So, perdition means a state of what? Eternal punishment and damnation in which a sinful and unpenitent person passes after death. So, perdition simply means loss of the soul, eternal damnation. Praise the Lord. So, and you agree with that? The man of eternal damnation is the Antichrist. Amen. It says that son of perdition will be revealed, who opposeth and exalted himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped. In my opinion, to my own understanding, I think that this is referring to the Antichrist. Praise the Lord. So, it says that he will be revealed. And says, so that he as God seated in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Amen. He's going to do a lot of terrible things. And what he says that, remember ye not that when I was with you, I told you these things? And now ye know what withholdeth that he might be revealed in his time. Praise the Lord. Only God knows what time it will happen. But I tell you, brethren, a lot of atrocities have been committed now. He says, for then, verse 8, for then shall that wicked be revealed, who the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. We might have to go into deep Bible study too. You would evaluate who this man really is. But I tell you, it's a very strange name that even him whose coming is after the working of Satan. Now, remember, this man is going to be what? He's going to be a, what I say, Satan is going to be his ogre master, because Satan is going to give him his trial, go and do all these things. And he says something, he says, with all power and signs and lying wonders. Now, ask him some people some questions sometimes. Ask them that, you know, if somebody was walking on the street now, and you were walking, and the person was shouting, Jesus is mighty, Jesus is powerful, hallelujah, believe in Jesus, and then somebody, people were crying, maybe they just shot one man and the man just died, and this young preacher just walked up to the man and just saying, in the name of Jesus I command you to rise up, and then the man who was shot dead rises up as if nothing happened to him. People will begin to shout, hallelujah, this man is a powerful man of God. This man is a powerful man of God. A powerful man of God. Praise the Lord. He says, with lying wonders. And the Bible does not say, by their gifts you shall know them. He said, the Bible said, Lord, by their fruit you shall know them. False prophets cannot be known by their gifts. False prophets can only be known by what? Their fruit. So that is why we should be very, very careful. The Bible says that if possible, the elect will be what? Will be deceived. How will the elect be deceived? You agree with me that if a Muslim comes and preaches to you and tells you that Allah is the way, believe in Allah and you will be saved. You can't be deceived by that. But if someone came and told you, Jesus is the way, believe in him and you shall be saved. That one you agree. But the man has a different agenda. Let us look at verse 10 as we approach the end. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. He says, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. Praise the Lord. No. Now, what are the set of people that are going to be deceived in this end time? What are the set of people that are going to, the Bible is saying that are going to what? Be full of unrighteousness. Those people who are hypocrites. People who are liars. Why are they hypocrites? They do not love the truth. People who don't love the truth. People who prefer what? They prefer lies. The Bible says that what? Because they love not the truth. Praise the Lord. That they might be saved. What will happen to them? In verse 11. And for this cause, God has sent them strong delusion that they should believe a lie. Amen. What is the kind of attitude for those people who will be deceived? He says that what those people who do not love the truth. Brethren, what is your attitude to the truth when they preach the truth to you? When they tell you the truth, are you the kind of person that says, the truth is too hard. The truth is too hard. Hey, are you the kind of person that says, that's your own way of looking at it? Me, I think that the Bible is this way. Are you the kind of person that when they pray the truth to you, you say, Father, please help me to obey this truth. I want to follow this truth. Are you the people that will just think and say, I would prefer to follow the other side. Praise the Lord. The Bible says that if you love not the truth, God will send a delusion on that person so that person should believe a lie. And he says that they all might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Praise the Lord. What is God saying today? That you ask yourself, this is a very serious issue. When I read this passage, I said, if men are trying to deceive you, devil is trying to deceive you, if God now decide to send a delusion on you, that person is finished. God is the only hope of this world. God is the only hope of this world. If God decides to turn against you, who can deliver you? Prayer is a very, very serious issue before us today. Let's turn our Bible to the book of Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7, as we round up. Matthew chapter 7, verse 22 to 23. Now, we'll see there what Jesus said. He says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Praise the Lord. Now, what are we saying? Matthew 7, verse 22 to 23. Praise the Lord. So, what are we saying today? What the Bible saying to us? Is that many will say unto Jesus, Lord, Lord, we did wonderful things in your name. And that's why, you know, now, these people, they prophesied in the name of the Lord. And the people who heard them were blessed. Amen. They were blessed. It's just like how we, we pray for a particular brother and God heals that brother. Like the other day, we prayed for Sister Mimi. Sister Mimi was healed. You know, we pray for Sister Jarato. Sister Jarato was healed. We pray for this. It happened. You know, the Bible is saying that these people, they prayed. They prophesied, and the people who they were ministering to were blessed. They did wonderful works in the name of the Lord. But Jesus will say to them, depart from me, I know you not. And the question is, how can somebody that God does not know perform miracles? I will only just tell you that I don't know how that happens. But because it's very strange, how can somebody that Jesus does not even know, you know, minister to somebody and that person is blessed? Is a serious thing that I can't begin to explain. But the Bible tells us, and Jesus will say, I never knew you, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Now, it is very possible for somebody to enter heaven with 12 sicknesses in their body. It's possible for someone to enter heaven with one eye. It is possible for someone to enter heaven without performing any miracle in their life. It's possible for somebody to enter heaven without even speaking even in one tongues. But it's never possible for anybody to enter heaven with even as little as one sin in their life. It's not possible. Brethren, what are we saying today? That performing miracles, healing people, is not the basis. And that's why many people will be deceived into following miracles. Into follow, like when I talk to some brethren, they usually ask me, but what about these people who prophesy? What are these people? What about these people who perform miracles, who speak in tongues, who the Lord is using mightily? The Bible is saying that this is the same thing. If possible, the elect will be deceived, they'll be deceived into following miracles. Brethren, please give me 2 more minutes. The Bible is saying that what and in verse 23, he said that Jesus will say to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you work of iniquity. They never invested time into knowing God personally. About the other day, was sharing with us what knowing God was. You should know God. They never invested the time to know God personally. And they never what? Invested time into what? Living a holy life. Project. As I round up today, what are the key things that the devil is trying to do? He's trying to get people from living a holy life into living a life of what? Emptiness. You know, many people now, they are more concerned. Like I remember I was talking to a particular girl. She was telling me that she now speaks in tongues. She can pray in tongues for 30 minutes. I say, wow. But I asked her, I told her that, you know, the most important thing is not that you're able to speak in tongues. The most important thing is that you're able to bear the fruit of the Holy Spirit. You know, she got annoyed. She said, I'm always discouraged. You know, she was not happy, you know. But that is what we are talking about, brethren. A lot of emphasis now is placed on gift instead of fruit. Brethren, the basis of the Bible says that let him that nameth the name of the Lord. In the book of 2 Timothy 2, verse 19, it said that, and the testimony of, you know, standeth sure, let him that nameth the name of the Lord, God knows those who are his. and let him that nameth the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. When I read that passage, I discovered that God knows those people who are truly his. Does God know you? Are you investing time into personally knowing God? Or are you just praying and believing in miracles? God used me mightily today in Australia. I prayed for 12 people. Demons jumped out. Brother, that is Jesus will say to those set of people who never invested time in knowing him and in living a holy life. I never knew you. They were given 2-count charges. One, that I don't know you. Two, you walk iniquity. Brethren, let not our focus be in sowing seed, in blessing the ministry, but let our focus be in decreasing the amount of sin in our lives and living a holy life, investing time in knowing God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I pray that the Lord will continue to explain these words to us in Jesus' name. Amen. I want us to bow down our heads as we pray. Domine, era blessed Lord, to the cross where thou wast died. Domine, era blessed Lord, to thy precious blood.